Francis, as we move into 2022, give us an idea of the economic forecast of overall economic growth.
Larysa, an easy question with a very, very difficult answer for this year. And here's the base case. The base case is the first half of the year has a lot of the same dynamics that impacted 2021, prices that are uncomfortably high and make us a little squeamish, with growth that is maybe not as strong as we were hoping for. By the second half of the year, the base case is that a lot of the supply chain bottlenecks start to unwind, that we really get onto more of a sustainable recovery, that COVID eventually fades into the rearview mirror, and we can get back onto a more sustainable, long-run, higher-end growth trajectory for the many years to come. And that's a base case, but Larysa, around a base case, we have to have risks. And my confidence in my base case is probably much lower than it has been in prior years, even last year, because as we go into 2022, we have this long list of known unknowns and things that could very dramatically change those base case outlooks, not the least of which is COVID itself. I wish we weren't talking about it anymore, but we are, because COVID, and particularly how governments choose to respond to COVID, could really thwart this relatively Goldilocks type of outlook. We don't know how long supply chain bottlenecks are going to take to unwind. We just have no precedent for it. And there are a lot of global dynamics, from OPEC to China, that could really change this somewhat glass half full outlook for 2022. So as always, we start with a base case and a main plan, but we may have to deviate from that over the course of the next 12 months.
Let's talk about some of these known unknowns, as you had just mentioned. Inflation, what's the overall trajectory? When do you expect rates to moderate?
We should see inflation come back down over the course of 2022, back towards 2% and maybe a little bit higher than that. But actually, my outlook for inflation has very little to do with whether or not the Bank of Canada hikes rates, because the vast majority of the inflation affecting Canadians is global and supply side driven. It has to do with what's happening with COVID zero and manufacturing plants in Asia, droughts in Latin America, trade negotiations happening globally. These are the factors that are really driving up a lot of Canadian inflation, not all of it, but a lot of it. Now, over the course of 2022, as some of these COVID distortions start to unwind, as I said, supply chain bottlenecks, COVID, as those start to dissipate, a lot of those price pressures are going to go back to their 2% year over year increase rate. But here's the problem. We've just experienced major inflation and the cost of living is much higher. And it's not likely that the cost of living is going to decline in the years to come. It's just going to stop growing at the same pace. So you'll hear a lot of narrative over the course of the next year that inflation is back to 2%. But for a lot of Canadians, they're still going to feel like their costs are much higher than they were 2 years ago.
As we approach this, time of known unknowns, as you had called them, what's the strategy for central banks around the world?
I don't envy their position at all. And the critical component here is that central banks are taking very different strategies across the entire world. And what's interesting is that they're largely facing the same problems, but positioning themselves with different types of solutions. So for example, the US and Canada have very similar inflationary dynamics, but the Federal Reserve in the US has said, yes, we want to engage in some form of normalization, but we can't address all elements of the inflation that's to come. So we're going to stay a relatively more dovish than some of our global central banking peers. The Bank of Canada, which has a single mandate, of course, that mandate has been slightly worded a little bit differently to make sure that we keep an eye on employment as well as on inflation, has really less policy flexibility because inflation is very, very high and out of the Bank of Canada's required or desired range. The problem for central bankers is if they mark to market, if they think about where the data is now, they should be very hawkish, especially in Canada, employment really back to pre-COVID and above levels, very high inflation. But that's not what worries me for central banks. What worries me is that extrapolating the current situation and saying we're going to continue on this path in 2022, think that might be a mistake because 2022 is going to come with much lower inflation. And I think in the first half of the year, some growth levels that make us a little more uncomfortable in those first 6 months. So central banks will have to choose, are we targeting current economic environments or are we thinking out where are we going to be a year and a half from now? It is a little bit like trying to target policy with moving goalposts.
Francis, you had mentioned that we are starting to see some of that unwinding when it comes to the supply chain bottlenecks. Give us an idea of what's the expectation for manufacturing and on the heels of that, where do we expect employment numbers to go?
Employment should stay fairly robust in Canada, but it's going to grow at a slower pace. We've recouped a lot of the losses in Canada, and that's not the same situation as the United States, where we still have a very serious labor force participation rate depletion. So the U.S. is facing a much worse labor market than Canada at this point. But on the point of manufacturing, there's a lot of conflicting elements underlying the surface here that make it a rather muddy picture. On one hand, we have China, which has slowed very steeply and is tightening or has tightened quite a bit. That's going to slow general manufacturing activity. On the flip side, as soon as those supply chain bottlenecks unwind and people can actually refill inventories, build up those depleted warehouses, you're going to have some additional tailwinds behind the manufacturing sector underneath the surface. So like a lot of 2021, when we think about manufacturing, we probably have to get more specific into specific manufacturing sectors. Which ones are most exposed to low-wage labor, which is seeing the highest wage increases? Which ones are most exposed to China? Which ones have the most inventory rebuild? It's not as easy as just a binary manufacturing yes or no. It's going to be much more granular in 2022, which is actually a theme for a lot of economic data.
A few months into that calendar year, Canadians will be waiting to hear what comes out of Ottawa when the Liberal government tables the federal budget. What is the expectation? What are you hoping to hear?
Well, generally, I suspect that in 2022, most of what happens for Canadians will probably be driven more by the monetary policy side. Do we see as many rate hikes as the market currently expects, as much as 5 is what the market is currently expecting? That would have much more dramatic impact for Canadians' lives, in my opinion, than much of what we might see in the budget. But of course, economists are always focused on what in a budget is going to rev up growth in the long term. In 2022, government spending is going to be much lower than 2021. And that's true in Canada, the US, every major nation across the globe is going to see a big pullback in the amount of government support in the economy. So we're always looking for things like infrastructure developments that can continue to keep this economy growing at a faster pace. Of course, we've seen really big moves in the childcare space, which most economists will tell you will raise labor force participation rate and help the economy in the longer run, really targeting this medium to long run type of economic support. That's what this Canadian economy needs now, less of the short term sugar rush, keeping Canadians afloat type of stimulus.